other social scientists in Kerala, in the Perissapalli place, as well as, of course, this supposedly lost Thomas of Cana place.
I hope that the indirect tradition can give some new insights.
Yeah, this must be new to the academic group in Kerala, because some of these documents I don't think is very well known in Kerala.
Some of them were studied in a very, very close circle only by one or two persons. And the other document that I will present in the beginning, I think, has never been studied.
Okay.
It was lying in the Leiden University library. Yeah. And apparently nobody was reading it.
Pardon?
Pardon? It was lying, that other document, which I find most interesting, and that we will, I hope, soon publish with Emmy Marin Joy, who wrote an MA thesis on that, and with whom we translated it. It needed really the knowledge of both of us, because it was a very difficult text. That text, I think, has, ever since it was written, has never been studied by anyone. Oh, somebody, okay. A presentation is... Okay. Am I called Marcos here?
Pardon?
I don't understand what has happened. Is someone presenting now?
Yeah, it is 2:30 now, and I'm waiting for the admin to intervene.
Yeah, but it says that I am presenting. No, he is not presenting.
Hello.
Hello, sir. So this is Rachel. I think somebody is presenting by mistake. I'll request them to stop.
Somebody is presenting, but I can't stop it.
Hello.
Hello, hello.
Hello, sir. Somebody is presenting by mistake. I'm just requesting the person to stop the person.
Okay.
Okay.
Yeah. May we start?
Yeah.
The KCHR is very happy to welcome you to our third webinar and Elamkulam Kunjan Pillai Memorial Annual Lecture by Professor István Perczel, A New Perspective on the 9th Century Christian Copper Plates, Testimony of the Indirect Text Traditions. May I request whoever is clicking on the presentation icon to kindly stop that, because it will interfere with the presentation of the speaker. So the lecture was originally planned as a public lecture in Thiruvananthapuram, and with the COVID situation, we were unable to organize that, Professor Perczel very kindly agreed to have this presentation by means of a webinar. We thank him very much for that. The session will be chaired by Professor Michael Theridan, Chairperson KCHR. Welcome, sir. And I take this occasion to welcome formally Professor István Perczel to give the Elamkulam Kunjan Pillai Memorial Annual Lecture for the KCHR. And I welcome everyone in the audience, and I request all of you to please switch on your switch off your mics, kindly keep it on mute. And also, after the once the question answer session starts, I request all of you to type in your questions in the chat box, which will be read out, and we will take as many questions as we can within 1 hour. I now request Professor Michael Theridan to kindly take over the proceedings.
Thank you very much, Dr. Rachel Varghese, and welcome every one of you for deciding to attend this session. And I would say a special word of welcome to Professor István Perczel, who very kindly agreed to deliver the Elamkulam PN Kunjan Pillai Memorial Annual Lecture 2020. As Rachel had already indicated, it was scheduled to be held in Thiruvananthapuram earlier, but you know, unfortunately, because of this COVID-19 situation, it had to be cancelled at that moment. But then, now we at least is having the possibility of discussing it as a webinar. Now, let me say a word in introduction, one or two words in introduction of Professor István. I'm sure that now his name is well known in this region because of his work. In fact, he has done quite a number of papers and monographs on Kerala-related subjects, and I'm sure that he is in all ways could be described as a Kerala historian, not a European historian working on Kerala, because of his extremely engaging involvement with historical issues related to Kerala. In fact, it is from, I think, around 2000 that he started his project on digitizing number of documents in this area, and also started writing on related subjects. And in fact, his work mainly has been on the 16th, 17th, and 18th centuries, I presume. He has written quite a bit on the efforts taken by a group of Christians in Kerala to keep up their earlier Chaldean traditions or Persian or Syriac traditions in spite of opposition from some very powerful groups, including the then dominating Portuguese power. And as part of his work, he has brought to the attention of the scholars here. Of course, it was already known, but it is in a much more deeper way. The Ghashuni kind of script, which is, as he has very rightly pointed out in one of his papers, it is something like a Semitic Dravidian mixture. It has got Vatteritha as well as Syriac alphabets. And this script has been used not only to record important events, but also to write poetry, to express artistic sentiments, And those kinds of work and the people who did that is coming into the forefront of attention in Kerala studies, primarily due to the work done by Professor István van Perczel. I wouldn't spend more time on István because we are all expecting his presentation to start immediately. And through his presentation, we will get an insight into the new arguments that he is going to present in terms of the Terissapalli copper plates, which of course is another topic of great interest in Kerala. Now, let me say a word in memory of Professor Elamkulam P.N. Kunjan Pillai. In fact, he is the doyen of the modern historians of Kerala. I use the word modern in the sense that, you know, people started writing history as history, not apologias and other kinds of lame excuses which were going in the place of history writing. In fact, in the historiography of Kerala, Kunjan Pillai has got a position which cannot be paralleled by most other people. In fact, he was very much in the tradition of the great language teachers of the region. In fact, he was trained as a Malayalam professor. But he did quite a bit of work on the related historical events. In fact, he is in that great tradition of Menomaniam Sundanar, Gobindanatha Rao, and others, who had also worked on epigraphic presentations. Now, P.N. Kunjan Pillai is being remembered not only by the KCHR, but by the whole historical community and students of other social sciences. And to mark our respect, we try to hold this memorial talk every year. Sometimes we have failed to maintain this annual nature of this talk, but at least this year, though belatedly, we have the opportunity to present it. Now, with these words, I hand over the presentation, hand over the desk to Professor István. Thank you.
Well, thank you, Professor Karakhan, for this warm introduction. I know that everybody understood that there was a lot of politeness in your introduction, and that my merits are much lesser than what you have said. And what I am going to present now, in order to honor the memory of Elamkulam Kunjan Pillai, who was really the pioneer of medieval studies in Kerala, I endeavor into there is some interference. Okay, so I would endeavor into something which is difficult for me: medieval history of Kerala, and this is a very difficult subject, and I am familiar to unknown or little known Malayalam documents containing indirect testimonies to the famous Egyptian copper plates, both the loose Thomas of Cana copper plates and the extant Terissapalli copper plates. With my unfortunately still limited linguistic skills, I could not have achieved anything without the help of three scholars. The first is Professor Keshavan Velutat, who had kindly revised with me the subject of the present talk and translated the most difficult document, a Garshuni Malayalam text which will be analyzed in the second part of the present lecture. The second whom I would like to thank is Mrs. Emmy Merinjoy, research scholar at Central European University, Budapest, Vienna, with whom the two of us translated the Leiden manuscript, which will be analyzed in the first part of the talk. Last but not least, Professor Susan Thomas, who unfortunately cannot be present now, has helped me throughout, but especially with the identification of the signatories of the column copper plates in Enquêteur du Perron's French transcript. Now I will like to, I will try to present my PowerPoint presentation. Can you see it? Can you see my PowerPoint presentation?
Yes, sir, we can see it now.
Oh, good. Okay. The Indian-Syrian Christians have a strong historical tradition on which their identity is based. Besides the founding tradition of St. Thomas' mission, they recount two arrivals in the distant past of Suryani merchant communities. The first is the arrival of the rich Persian merchant, Thomas of Cana, or in Malayalam, Knai Thomas. Current tradition also assigns a date to his arrival, 345 CE, and knows about 72 families who arrived together with him. It is reported that Thomas arrived in Mahadeva Pattanam, the city of the great god, that is Shiva, which is placed either in Kodungallur or by early 17th century authorities in the neighborhood of North Paragur. Precisely, the side of the Further, the help of a bishop and clergyman belonging to the church who accompanied him, he reorganized the religious life of the Christians, who by that time had fallen to such spiritual indigence that they were intermarrying with the Nayars, and their lifestyle did not differ from that of the latter. This is in the Portuguese documents. The early Portuguese reports tell similar stories, albeit with much variation, even as to the dates concerned, which vary from the first Christian centuries to the ninth. At the source of all these stories lies a document, now lost, which was written on copper plates and whose only remnant is a Portuguese translation contained in a text entitled Narrative about Malankara, written in 1604. Relatado sobre a Serra, feito em 1604. Now kept in the British Library. It was supposed to have been the first European Archbishop of the Syrian Christians. It is this text. Can you see it?
Excuse me, sir. Could you please restart the presentation? Because I think when someone joined, that presentation went into a minimum mode.
Oh.
So could you please restart it?
So please tell me when you can't see it, because.
Yes.
Then I have to restart. Okay. Can you see it now? Oh, no, not yet. Can you see it now?
Not yet, sir.
But I have...
Yeah,
I
now it's all right. Now it's all right. Yes.
Okay, good. From current slide. Okay. Can you see it now?
Yes, yes. Thank you.
Oh, good. Okay. So this is the first page of this famous Relação sobre a Serra, which was written in 1604, and people think it was written by the famous first European Archbishop, the Jesuit Francisco Rose, but it is not stated in the text. Okay. Yes. The copper plates, which have been lost, were in the custody of the Syrian metropolitan Mark Jacob, who was in Malabar between 1504 and 1549, who, because of his poverty, pawned them to an anonymous person from whom, upon Mark Jacob's request, The plates were redeemed by the treasurer of the Portuguese factory in Cochin, who was called Pero de Sequeira. According to de Sequeira's testimony, the grant was written on two plates, written on both sides. De Sequeira showed them to the governor of Kochi, Martim Afonso de Souza, who had it translated by a Jew who was able to read the Waterloo script. Then the plates were kept in the Portuguese factory of Cochin, but according to the testimony of Diogo do Couto, who wanted to place them in the archives, some archives in Lisbon, by the end of the 16th century, the copper plates were lost through carelessness, so that what we have now is the Portuguese translation made on the basis of the Malayalam reading of the Jewish interpreter. Can you hear me?
Yes, we can hear you.
Okay. According to the Portuguese translation of the copper plates, the king of Kodungallur donated Mahadevar Pattanam to Thomas and gave 72 houses to the families that came together with him. Hence the tradition of a first Persian settlement on the Malabar coast, which had arrived in the 4th century and included entire settler families. Because of the early date attributed to this settlement, 345 AD, it is believed that Thomas of Cana and the clerics who came with him were those who established the original connection with the Church of the East. This tradition is firmly believed by most of the Syrian Christians in Kerala and beyond. Yet, although the copper plates are believed to have been lost, the tradition can and should be corrected as to the nature and the date of the migration, as it has been demonstrated by the great Kerala scholar T.K. Joseph. The motif of 72 houses or families comes from a misreading of the phrase Erupatirandu Vidupere. Sorry for my pronunciation. 72 privileges, a necessary component of all these copper plate grants, by reading instead of Vidu with short E, Vidu, house with long E. Thus, it was not entire families, but single settlers who arrived with Thomas and received the 72 privileges. There were no 72 houses of the Anjuvannam and Manigramam trade guilds, being those of the foreign merchants trading with the local ones and consisting of Jewish, Christian, Zoroastrian, and in view of the probable date of the arrival, also Muslim members. Apparently, those settlers intermarried with the local women. Definitively, the 4th century date should also be corrected. There are two manuscripts in the Leiden University Library, namely Leiden Oriental 1213, this is the beginning of the manuscript, and 1214, this is the beginning of the manuscript, which contain a church history written in the early years of the 18th century and sent most probably to Heinrich Schaff, professor of Semitic languages at the University of Leiden. The church history was written in the community and on behalf of Mar Gabriel, a Nestorian bishop who came to India in 1705. It was written in Malayalam, this is the original text, but as Schaff was not supposed to know Malayalam, a Syriac translation thereof was made, and the two texts were sent together. Apparently, ever since, nobody or almost nobody had read the original, only the Syriac was read. And also, only the Syriac was known, and I must say, seriously misunderstood by scholars, but now Amy Merinjoy and I have translated the Malayalam text too. This text contains original datum, as the Syriac is in fact a loose paraphrase, also containing independent elaborations and frequent misunderstandings. Now, this is what we read about Thomas of Cana and his copper plates in the Malayalam Church History of Leiden. You can read it, but I am also reading it aloud. Reaching a time after the Apostle Mar Thoma had accomplished his time, that is, when he died, and after the death of the priests in India and in Malayalam, as I told, India is Tamil Nadu and Malayalam is Kerala in this text. There arose against the way and the baptism Manikkavacher, the magician, and also came to my level and performed diverse signs. And because he commanded not to baptize and set a ban on it, in those days in which all the chief men and the headmen left the baptism and believed in Manikavachar, the common people, in order not to be shaken and not to leave the way and the baptism, left India and came to Malayalam. Those who were already in Malayalam and those who came from India became related to each other, that is, intermarried. Therefore, because of the lack of priests and because there was no increase in the number of those who were aware of the truth, and because some of them were with the Kavyar, that is, the Hindus, out of 160 families who were counted as Christians, Nasranis, who lived in Malayalam in those days, 96 families left the way and 64 remained. In those times, as a high priest ruling in the kingdom called Urahai, that is Edessa, presently in eastern Turkey, had seen a vision in his night dream, for this reason, according to the order of the Catholicos of the East, the head of the East Syrian Church, a trader who was living in Jerusalem, a Christian called Thomas, because of his trade, and because if there were Christians in Malayalam, he would have met them, came by a ship, and having reached Malayalam, he soon summoned all the Christians from Malyamkara to Tiruvankur, met them, spoke to them abundantly, and reassured all the 64 Christian households that were in Malayalam as his younger and older brothers, and again boarded the ship, went away, and reaching Jerusalem, he arrived. Then he reached where the Catholicos was dwelling, and after informing him about all the circumstances, according to the order given by the Catholicos, the Metropolitan, who was ruling the place called Urahai, priests, deacons, Christians, along with women and children from Bangladesh, Nineveh, and Jerusalem, together with the merchant Thomas, sailed away again, reached Malayalam, and in the year 345 of Christ, they arrived in Malayalam. The 64 houses of Christians who were in Malayalam coming together discussed and went to the then ruling king, the Lord Cherakon Perumal, met him, and having explained the entire situation in front of His Majesty understood, and he designated the country of Kodungallur, drawing its boundaries, and separated sufficient land for a church, Palli, and a market quarter, Pattanam. And His Majesty the Lord King Cherakon was gracious to have written on a copper plate every privilege of close to royal status that the Suryani Christians should enjoy, and to administer as long as the sun and the moon would last, and this place that he has given and they have built, Podutapadi Vannicha Takaduka, can still be seen. After this, in the land designated in the country of Kodungallur, they built a church, and from east to west in south-north direction, 472 shops and houses behind the shops were built. In those days and in later times, when they lived according to the way and the customs, very often from Bangladesh and from Nineveh and from Jerusalem and from other directions, by the order of the Catholicos of the East, Suryani high priests came to Malayalam and they ruled over the Suryanika who were in Malayalam. This text is remarkable in many ways. First of all, it connects the arrival of the colonist group of Thomas of Kana with the destruction of the main settlement of the Christians in Malayalam. The result of the persecutions of Manikavachakar, who is a well-known historical figure, a 9th century Shaiva saint, one of the founders of Shaiva Bhakti, whose 51 hymns entitled Tiruvachagam, the sacred word, constitute the 8th volume of the Tamil Shaiva canon of devotional hymns. According to tradition, Manikavachakar lived in the 9th century and was the son of a minister of a Pandya king. Although the Bhakti hagiographic works do not mention any tension between the movement and the Christian community, they are replete with violent acts against the Jains and the Buddhists. Traditionally, the Indian Christians were also called Buddhists by Hindu sources. Besides the Leiden histories, Most Portuguese reports of the late 16th century tell similar stories and know of the arrival of Thomas in Kodungallur following the destruction of Christianity in Mailapur. Those which depend on the lost copper plates and not on the Portuguese translation also date the arrival to the 9th century, namely the report of Francisco Dionisio, Jesuit rector of Cochin. I think these elements of the indirect text tradition allow us to reject the traditional 4th century dating quite safely and assign a 9th or eventually even 10th century dating to the Thomas of Kano mission. Other elements of the indirect tradition of the copper plates confirm this dating that is radically later than that of the present tradition. Second, while according to the testimonies of Diogo da Couto and Antonio Gouveia, the Thomas of Kano copper plates had been lost, this text knows it otherwise. It says, these plates that he has given and they have bought, you see it on the screen, Kodottapadi Vangicha Takadukal, can still be seen. This seems to mean that what was lost through carelessness for the Portuguese might have been gained for the Syrian Christians who got back their foundational document from the Portuguese. I even wonder whether the expression Kodutapadi Vangicha Takadukal means that the copper plates that had been pawned and were in the custody of the Portuguese factory in Cochin were bought back by the community. Third note, the testimony of the Leiden Malayalam manuscript contains elements that are missing from the extant Portuguese translation of the Thomas of Kano grants. In the Portuguese translation, we read for the name of the king, Coquarangon or Cocharangon. But the text here has Rajavu Cherakon Perumal Tamburan, that is the King Lord Cherakon Perumal. Of course, the Malayalis knew what was the real name of the king, so this is not a very strong argument. However, the Leiden manuscript also contains the standard formula for the validity of the grant, as long as the sun and the moon would last. And interestingly, this standard formula is nowhere in the Portuguese text. Also, the statement that the mixed local Christian Persian Christian community received close to royal privileges, which they could enjoy and transmit to others, presumably to their descendants. Again, this is not in the text because it has mistranslated in the Portuguese text because it has mistranslated the privileges to families. It also says, the text also says that a palli, that is a sanctuary and a pattanam, that is a market quarter around it, was built, and the text even gives the structure of the market city. From east to west in south-north direction, 472 shops and houses behind the shops are built. I think this is to be understood as describing the structure of the Christian market in Kodungallur. It consisted in two rows of shops, facing each other along a street stretching from east to west. Apparently, the northern row belonged to those who were later called the Northerners, Vadakumbaga, and the southern row belonged to those who were later called the Southerners, Tekumbaga. Of course, we cannot judge how reliable this information is, but at least it is interesting. All in all, it seems that the information contained by this text is not based on the Portuguese translation of the lost copper plates, as the present-day tradition generally is, but perhaps on the copper plates themselves. Now, let us switch to the other set of royal grants, the Kolam copper plates. Placing Thomas of Cana's arrival in the 9th century would make his arrival relate to another settlement that arrived in Kollam sometime after 825, the founding date of the city and the beginning of the Malayalam era. Thus, if the arrival of Thomas' community is to be placed in the 9th, eventually the 10th century, this was not the moment when the link with the Persian church was established. There are concordant data indicating that, at an earlier time, the principal point of contact of the Persian merchants and the Persian church with India was in Mylapur at the Coromandel coast, which was also the see of the Bishop of India. There was apparently a Bishop of India. The 9th-10th century colonization and the arrival of Persian bishops at the Malabar coast was most probably the result of the destruction of the community at the eastern coast and the transfer of the community's center of gravity to the west. We are much better informed about the arrival of the settler community that arrived in Kollam, given that the royal grant of the privileges given to them is extant on 5 copper plates dated to 849 AD. Now, the original text of the copper plates has been reconstructed by Professors Raghava Varier and Keshavan Velutat, and soon their freshly made English translation will also be published in a monograph jointly written under the editorship of Elizabeth Lamborn of De Montfort University in Leicester, UK, dedicated to the Kollam copper plates. The grant recorded on the plates was donated by Ayan Adhikar Tiruvadhikar, His Highness the ruler of Ai, the governor of Vennad, in the 5th year of the Chera Emperor's Tanuradi, that is, in 849. Unlike what one can see from the Portuguese translation of the Rose Thomas of Cana plates, which is a narrative text, the Kollam plates contain a real grant for the foundation of a settlement, or emporium, Nagaram, situated in the seaport around a sanctuary called Tarisapaldi. As suggested by a member of the team of Elizabeth Lamborn, Philip Wood, the letter is most probably a composite word from the Malayalam Palli settlement, non-Hindu sanctuary, and Tarsa, the early New Persian variant of the Middle Persian Tarsak, derived from Tars, fear, and meaning the one who fears, God-fearer, which meant in the Persian context a Christian. So that Tarisapali would mean a Christian place of worship. Apparently, the denomination follows the community's self-identification, from which we understand that it was Persian-speaking. The community attached to the church receives servant families, apparently as slaves. Here is one plate. I think it is the third copper plate. And this is the testimonies of the foreign traders. So, the community attached to the church receives servant families as slaves to guarantee that the church is not lacking anything in the form of oil, etc., by sowing what is to be sown and giving what is to be given. The right of self-governance and exemption from taxes is granted, and also large incomes and the right to levy tolls and taxes. To guarantee that the church is not lacking anything in the form of oil seems to be a symbolic expression, meaning that extensive privileges are given to the community centered on a place of worship. Similar expressions are used in Chera grants given to Hindu, Buddhist, and Jain communities, as one can read in M.G.S. Narayana's book, Cultural Symbiosis in Kerala. This is also evidence for the official acceptance of the worship conducted in the Tarisa sanctuary. It is said in the grant that the church was founded by one Maruvan Sapir Isho, whose name seems to be a Persian Syriac composite. Maruvan is a common Persian name often used by Christians. Isho is the East Syriac pronunciation of Jesus, and is much used among Nestorian Christians, while Sapir means learned erudite in Syriac. Thus, the name probably means Maruhan, Jesus, the learned one. This name has been often identified with the more common East Syrian name Sabrisho, hope in Jesus, but this is contradicted by the other variant, which is also occurring in the same grant, Esho da Tapir or Sapir I. This letter seems to be a Syriac Malayalam composite, Esho, Syriac Jesus, Da, Syriac who, Tapir or Sapir, learned, I is Malayalam is. So Jesus who is the learned. There was considerable confusion about these two variants of the name in the grants. And what I am proposing is a hypothesis, but I hope it's a consistent hypothesis. The name Sabrisho, usually used as a name for clerics, could not be written in this second way. It is understood that the privileges are witnessed by Muslim, Christian, Zoroastrian, and Jewish witnesses. The Muslims sign in Arabic written in Kufic script, the Christians and the Zoroastrians in Middle Persian written in Pahlavi characters, and the Jews in early Judeo-Persian written in Hebrew script. The god venerated in the church is referred to as Tevar, deity, without any specification of who this deity is. In fact, the copper plates are not a religious, but a purely legal document, which is given to receive a rich foreign merchant community to settle them and to give them the traditional privileges of the Malankara aristocracy. In the local Christian tradition, Sapirisho is remembered as a rich merchant who settled in Kollam and brought with him two bishops with Persian names, Mar Shabur and Mar Afrahat, who became Mar Shabro and Mar Prod in the Portuguese documents, who were to be venerated as the great saints of the Malankara church and to whom many churches were dedicated. What was the occasion for the arrival of this new settler community? Antonio Guver says that they arrived a few years after the founding of the city of Kulam. From this narrative, we learn that the colony of Maruvan Sapirisho came after the founding of Kulam, whence the Malayalam illustrates. Apparently, Kulam was founded in 825 as a new port city where the king invited foreign merchants to settle. So most probably the founding and building of the Tarisapalli is posterior to 825 and should be dated around the 840s. Can you hear me? Hello?
Yes, we can hear you.
Okay. Good, because I lose the contact.
We can hear you.
Okay, thus the Malayalam era begins with the founding of a new port city by the king Stanu Revi, but is not connected to Sapirisho himself. Because of this, the view that is generally held, namely that Kollam was founded by Sapirisho, who arrived in the year 823, should be revised. So also should be revised the widespread misreading of the name Maruhan Sapirisho as Mar Sabrisho. Mar Sabrisho, and his identification with one of the bishops, Mar Shabur, based on one of the Portuguese transcriptions of the letter's name as Mar Sapor. The grant is clearly given to a lay merchant community, which is identified as Christian, Tarsa, Tarisa. The foundation and growth of the port city of Kollam is to be linked to the intense conflict between the Chera kings, whose capital was Magodaya Pattanam, near Kodungallur, and the Pandyas, centered on Madurai. In the early 9th century, the Pandyas attacked the kingdom of Ai and occupied it, together with its capital and port city, Vizhinjam, 15 kilometers south of present-day Tiruvananthapuram, while the Cheras moved in and occupied the Vale country to the north of Ai. It was the loss of Vizhinjam, an ancient port with remnants of Indo-Roman trade, to the Pandyas, which prompted the foundation of Kollam as a rival port. Apparently, under the 9th century Pandyas, a Hindu restoration took place in present-day Tamil Nadu, also introducing the new Bhakti movement, in which aimed to sweep away Buddhism, Jainism, and probably also Christianity. At the same time, their Western neighbors and rivals, the Cheras, were practicing religious tolerance, even religious pluralism. There are also copper, this was beautifully exposed by M.G.S. Narayana. There are also copper plate charters concerning Chera donations to a Buddhist monastery, Vihara, to Jain temples and to Jewish merchants. This attitude attracted foreign merchants, be they Jewish, Zoroastrian, Christian or Muslim, to populate the new port city of Kola. If indeed the Christians were expelled from the Pandya Empire, it is comprehensible that the Cheras, who followed the Pandyas, gave them shelter. Thus, the foundation of the Tarisapali must have been part of a complex process of the decline of the Christian merchant community at the Coromandel coast and its parallel rise at the Malabar coast. Now, what is the contribution of the indirect text tradition of the Kolan copper plate? This hitherto neglected indirect text tradition permits us to formulate a new hypothesis, and I stress it's a hypothesis, concerning the provenance not only of the Kolan copper plates, but also of the Thomas of Kana copper plates, and eventually to give a dating for the latter. This indirect tradition was, as far as I know, first treated by Jacob Kollaparampil. Jacob Kollaparampil in a mimeographed publication of limited distribution. Basically, almost nobody had access to it, but has never been properly taken into consideration in the scholarly literature. Two transcripts of the Kolan copper plates are extant. Francisco Rose got made a transcript of the entire document by a certain Itimani Kattanar into Garshuni Malayalam script in 1601. Later, John Baptist Murtedo of St. Teresa, Bishop of Warapura, in the first half of the 18th century, got a transcript in Granda or Arya Uttu of the original Vata Uttu, which was interpreted by a certain Mattai Kattanar from Angamali in poor Portuguese for the French traveler and Indologist Jacinthe Anquetil de Perron. Abraham Jacinthe Anquetil de Perron. Duperron translated the Portuguese interpretation of Mattai Kattanar into French and included it in his travelogue in the introduction of his translation of the Zend Avesta. The Arya Uttu transcript has not been found to date. Both the Garshuni Malayalam transcript and the French text of Anquetil de Perron arranged the five plates precisely in the order which was recently established by Raghava Varia and Keshavan Veduta. So this is a very strong confirmation that their work is really absolutely reliable on the basis of internal criteria. While earlier scholarship considered the two sets of copper plates as containing two separate grains, still in the publication by M.G.S. Narayanan, the two, the Kolan copper plates are presented as two separate grains. Also by T.K. Joseph. Also, while the text of the first three plates in the direct tradition is similar to that reflected in the indirect text tradition, the text of the fourth plate differs from the other four, contains much less text than the other ones, and corresponds only to the first half of the text reflected in the indirect tradition. Its text is interrupted there. Its text is interrupted there where the signatures of the local dignitaries, a necessary part of the medieval royal copper plate grants, begins. Thus, from the indirect text tradition, it can be established beyond any reasonable doubt that the presently extant fourth plate is only the first part of a copy of the lost fourth plate. In fact, it was a general habit that, when a document got damaged but was still partly legible, a copy was made of it by which the original was replaced. Although here, other hypotheses are also possible, as I will say later. But in this case, apparently, to replace the fourth plate, two plates were used. I repeat, the fourth plate was still there by the indirect extradition, both by those who were working for Francisco Rose and by those who wrote the Granda transcript. And then the fourth plate, which is in the bottom right corner of this slide, was transcribed in two plates, but only the first plate from the fourth plate, from the transcription of the fourth plate, is extant, while the second was lost. However, the paleographical situation is even more complicated and seems to contradict the above results that I drew from the indirect extradition. Professors Raghava Varia and Keshavan Vedutat have established that the plates show considerable paleographic variation, which you can see on this picture. According to them, plates 1 and 4, plate 1 is in the left upper corner and 4 in the right lower bottom corner. Plates 1 and 4 are written in a script that can be judged as belonging to the 9th century, while plates 2 and 3, 2 is in the upper right corner and 3 is in the bottom left corner, are written in a later script. Accordingly, plates 2 and 3 would be copies of earlier texts. Now, it is true that plates 1 and 4 are written in a much more beautiful and clear water script than plates 2 and 3. You can judge it yourself if you look at these pictures. There is also another important difference. In the middle of the writing of the verso side of the first plate, whose recto side is blank, this is what you see in the upper left corner, there is a carve in the very middle. You see a carving in an in a script which is up to date undeciphered. Nobody can read it, which was engraved later when the Waterloo writing was complete. To me, it looks like a signature or an authentication mark. Now, authentication marks of the same type can also be read in the last lines of plates 2 verso and 3 verso, which you see in the upper right and the bottom left corner. But they are included in the text. You see in the last line those strange characters in both. They are included in the text in a very rough version, showing that the scribe or carver had copied the mark in a rather approximative manner, not understanding its meaning. Basically, it's the same mark which is in clear script in the first plate. However, there is no such mark on plate 4. I'm also giving the verso side here, and there is no such mark on plate 4, which does not resemble plate 1 either. So I would suggest that out of the four plates with better to writing, plate 1 is the earliest, plates 2 and 3 are clearly copies of the lost originals, while plate 4 is either a later copy written in an archaizing script, which resembles more 9th century Waterloo, or was adopted from a parallel earlier copy, because apparently several copies of this text existed, to replace the lost fourth plate. All this shows that making copies of the original plate was an accepted practice. The Garshuni Malayalam transcript, where is it? Ah, it's here. The Garshuni Malayalam transcript and the necessarily poor quality French text of Enquêtes du Perron permit the reconstruction of the missing part of the original fourth plate. The presently extant fourth plate contains the concluding formula of the original royal grant. You see it on the left corner, after which the signatures of the local dignitaries begin. So in Narayanan, MGS Narayanan translation, this is agreed to by Velkula Sundaran, and the next signature Vijaya. Also, this is exit 2 by Vijaya. Sorry, it was omitted. However, the text is interrupted in the middle of the second name, Vijaya, but continues, if you, as you can see, that it continues in Duperron's French text, which contains the names of 17 dignitaries, some of them also mentioned in the main text. The signatures were not copied in the Garshuni Malayalam text. Now, here is the end of the Tarissa Pali grant in Duperron's text. I am not reading the French. I am just showing you that simply the same text continues because Duperron had access to an earlier version of the fourth plate, which contained more than the fourth plate contains now, because it is only the first part of a copy, which was made in two plates. Now, the reconstruction of the names by Professor Susan Thomas, and it can still be it can still be refined, attested by Velkula Sundaram, attested by Vijaya Narayanan, attested by Idirashi Udayakuranam Nadonan, and so on and so on. 17 officers of the Chera, of the governor of Venet. Now, remarkable are among the names of the signing officer the three names which you have in the right column: Pulai Kutti Tanvartanan, Punnai Talai Kutti Ududayan Ikannan, and Punnai Talai Kuttinia Kumaraya Kannan. You will tell that the reconstructions are not perfect, and I am accepting all suggestions. Because in the prologue to the grant, it is stated the following. In that year, Ayanadika Tiruvadikal, the ruler of Venad, assembled together with the officials, Adhikara, the elements of the state, Pirakirudi, the Manikkaraman and the Anjuvanman, and the chief of the village of Punnaitalai, Punnaitalai Padi. Apparently, Ududayan Ikannam and Kumaraya Kannam were from the village of Punnaitalai, and one of them could be the chief of Punnaitalai, Punnaitalai Padi. Also, Pulai Kutti Tanvartanam, the fourth name from below in the right column, could be the chief of the village of Pulai Kutti, who is also mentioned in the grant. As the land given to the Tarisapali was neighboring the villages of Punnaitalai and Pulai Kutti, the chiefs of these villages also had to sign the document. The other signatories are more difficult to identify. After that comes a paragraph extant in both witnesses about Thomas of Cana and the grants he received, with a date given according to astronomical constellations and other precious information. Yet, this paragraph is odd. It looks like the beginning of a text, but its text is interrupted. Here is the translation by Professor Keshavan Vedutat. I was together with Emmy Merinjoy, we tried to translate it. We arrived to some result, but it was not good enough. This is an old language that we were not able to understand. So, but luckily, Professor Keshavan Vedutat helped. This is the story of the origin of Kodungallur Nagaram. When in olden days it was known as Pattanam Nagaram, Sakkara Vittyan from Kolla Kodungallur met the Adhikariyan, the governor, joined his hands in salute, and asked for a land, the desham, laid by mud, clay, chakuti, mangroves, shrub, and salt. In that year he, the governor, measured, gave and ordered with the measure of anakos, that is big kos, 4,444 kol on the 29th day of the month of Nagaram, a Saturday, the Rohini asterism, called in the West Aldebaran, Saptami, the seventh day of the fortnight, when Jupiter was in the sign of Kunjan, Aquarius. That day, the Vadil Madam, the temple of Irinyalakuda, together with the church, was consecrated. That day, it was called Magodevar Pattanam, and in this Pattanam, a Nagaram was established, and in that Nagaram was established the right of building a decorated gateway, Porerum, and moreover, these two, the drums and the Korava, the auspicious sound, the blowing of conch, firework, feather on the body, puniri, flowery sprinkled water. The foreign Christian, Nasranis, Knai Tumman, put it in writing. Thereof is witnessed the sun and the moon, in the handwriting of the ruler of the day. What follows next is the signatures in Arabic and Persian. These may or may not correspond to the members of the merchant guilds Anjuvanam and Manigranam mentioned in the text of the Tarisapali plates, but their exact meaning becomes ambiguous because of the last paragraph. Now, my hypothesis, and I am stressing that it's only a hypothesis, is that this paragraph is nothing other, this final paragraph, is nothing other than the first part of the Lowest Thomas of Canapopper plates, of which we possess only the imprecise Portuguese translation. And I think that the two sets, that is to say the Kollamkopper plates and the Thomas of Canapopper plates, once belonged together as one document witnessing the privileges received by the Christian community through the two grants given to the two settlers. According to this hypothesis, none of the copper plate sets was the original document, but they were parts of a unified copy of the two grants. Moreover, the second is not the grant itself, but a narrative about the grant, which apparently by that time the community has already lost. It's a narrative about the foundation of Kodungallur Nagaram, that is, of the marketplace and emporium of the Christians in Kodungallur. In fact, the lowest Malayalam or Tamil document underlying the Portuguese translation is also a narrative, which may be joined easily to this one. And it lacks these expressions, the as soon as the sun and the moon would last. It lacks also the date. According to my hypothesis, sometime during the history of the community, the two parts of the grants were separated so that the group centered on Kodungallur kept the Thomas of Kana plates and the one centered on Kollam kept the Tarisapali plates. But the separation could not be made perfectly, as the copy of the Thomas of Kana plates began immediately after the signatures of the Tarisapali plates on the same fourth plate. So the first paragraph of the Thomas of Kana plates was cut off from the main text. If such was the case, it is difficult to decide to which grant the Arabic and Persian signatures had belonged originally, as they could belong to any one of the two, or to both, as the plate with the Arabic and Persian signatures must have been the last plate of the entire document. It is even possible, and this is what I find not even possible but probable, that the signatories were witnessing the faithfulness of the copy containing the two documents. If the dating through astronomical constellations could be deciphered, and for the time being I couldn't find anybody to decipher it, we would know the precise date of the Thomas of Kana plates. Yet even until then, it seems so that Francisco Dionisio, the Jesuit rector of Cochin, who made his conjecture when the Thomas of Kana plates were not yet lost, had the correct information. Thomas of Kana came after and not before Maruvansa Pirisho. Thank you. Okay. So let me tell you. Okay. So I hope that it was comprehensible. Because
thank you, sir.
I couldn't.
Yeah, it was.
The contact with the audience, and this makes it difficult. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. May I request Professor Michael Tharagan to unmute the mic and continue with the proceedings?
Yes,
Professor Tarakan, we can't hear you because you are muted. We don't hear anything. Please unmute yourself. Professor Tarakan, please unmute yourself.
Hello.
Oh, good. Now we can hear you.
Okay. I've been trying all this while to get myself unmuted, but I was kept muted all along. So I would request, first of all, let me thank you for the good presentation. Now, I would request Dr. Rachel Varghese, to conduct the open discussion session. There may be, she must have already collected some names from people who would like to make their points and comments and all that. So I would request Dr. Rachel Varghese to conduct this session.
Thank you, sir.
Yeah.
Thank you, sir. I request the audience to kindly type in any queries or comments they have in the chat box. We already have a comment and a query from Father Baiju Matthew. I will read them out together. First, the Malayalam text 1214 writes, Cherakon Perumal Tamburan, Thiruvallam Cheyda Kodutha Padi Vangicha Thagidugal, which does not bring the Portuguese in between. This is a comment. And also, there's a query. Professor Istavan, I think you have not said anything on the Damio de Goes report in 1566. So would you like to respond to that query?
No. I should see the. How can I see the questions? Because it's.
You can click on the chat box.
And Rachel, can I explain?
Yes, please. Father Baiju, you can ask the question.
Okay. I'm Father Baiju, belonging to Knanai community. So I'm most interested. And I wish to thank you for your great effort to study and to explain these things, and for KCHR, which has organized this seminar. With regard to the first one that I have mentioned, when you said that the shepherd kurta padi vangichu, that would be through the Portuguese. But I think in Malayalam, kurta padi, that means which was given by the king and got or taken by Knaitoma. So there won't be the interlocution of Portuguese, I think. Then the second one, I think, the report of the Miao Go is in 1566, which is well established, will written in the book, which I think you have already mentioned, Dr. Jacob Kullabrambil, who has collected and reported all these documents in 1987 already, with all the documents that you have mentioned here. He has given also this report of the Miao de Goes in 1566, which clearly speaks of the Knaitoman shepherd being read by a Jew by the order of the Cochin king. And he says that there are two copper plates which is hung by through a copper wire. So it was a copper plate intact as such. And then it is written in three languages as it is written here, Chaldean, Malabar, and Arabic. The introduction of a Jew itself speaks that it is not written in Grantha or Vatteluthu. Otherwise, at that time, usually the kings used to write in Grantha or Vatteluthu. So bringing a Jew in between would all really suggest such a different language and ancienity of the language. I too agree with you with your suggestion that the fifth leaf of the Therisapalli copperplate as it is known today would be a part of the Knaithoma Shepherd, listening to the different languages involved in the script of the Knaithoma Shepherd. That's what I wanted to say.
Oh, thank you for both your comments. Now I understand, and I hope I can answer. I told you that although I am steadily studying Malayalam, I am still, I am not good enough. And your language is quite difficult. And I am heavily relying on my collaborators. And when we were translating, I hope that Emmy Marin is here. When we were translating this document, I several times asked Emmy, isn't it not that what you suggest, that it simply they got that the king gave and they received? And she said, no, it means they have both. So I am as I told you, much is hypothetical here, and I am very happy to withdraw the idea that they bought it back, but I see here still interesting things. And what you meant, before I go on with this part, let me turn to Damião de Góes. That report, which I said it is Pero de Sequeira's report, this is transmitted by Damião de Góes. And he says that, I did not quote it in extenso, and he says very interesting things. Now, one very interesting thing is he gives the very measures of the plates, and he says that they were written on both sides, and they were connected through the. Now I can't show the pictures. They were by a thread. Now, what is interesting with the column copper plates is that the first plate, and this is although not an exclusive custom in medieval copper plates, but it's rather the rule that the first plate you can recognize by the fact that the first page, the recto side of the plate, is not written, is not inscribed. The text begins on the verso side of the plate. Now, what we can see, this is again not conclusive, but a warning sign, that the Thomas of Cana plates were written on both sides. This may not, but also may indicate that they were not from the very beginning. I hope it's comprehensible. That is to say, if it were a regular document, they would be from the beginning. Now the other, Damião de Góes writes also that there were Hebrew and Arabic. I don't remember. Does he mention
Chaldean and Arabic?
Chaldean and Arabic. Yeah, Chaldean and Arabic. Now, this doesn't perfectly fit. This doesn't perfectly fit what we have, because in the Kolam copper plates on the fifth plate we have Arabic, Pehlevi, and Hebrew, but who knows whether Pero de Sequeira, whose report Damião Góes transmits, whether they recognize the characters. They see that some other characters are intermingled. Now, because the Thomas of Cana plates were lost, we don't know what was there, because also up to the present day, even scholars tend to omit what they don't understand. Instead of saying, here is something I don't understand, they omit in their translations. So we don't know, but it's really strange, but the whole report is very contradictory. And what I find most contradictory is that neither the Portuguese translation of those plates, nor this paragraph, which is in the Garshoni transcript, and also, it is also in a very poor French translation, in the French text of Enquêtes du Perron, much, much shorter. They are not a regular copper plate grant. They are a narrative. They are a narrative about a grant received by the community. So the whole text gives the impression of a being a secondary text. But as I tried to show, although apparently the Kunjan copper plates are a faithful transmission of the original text, they are not the original. The only plate which has a chance to be the original is the first plate. The second and the third are clearly copies, and I am arguing, and in this sense I am diverting from Raghava Varier and Keshavan Venutat, that the fourth is definitively a copy. So the first is certainly the most ancient part of the collection. So what we should not only understand, in this 19th century Western manner of always searching for the original and often not finding it, instead we should understand the use of these plates in the community and what was happening to them. So I return to your first question. I think what you propose is much more logical than what we are saying with Emmy, and I am very happy to yield if this is really good Malayalam. And then let us drop this argument that it was brought back. But what strikes me are those elements in the late 18th century narrative which cannot be based on the Portuguese text, which is extant. And all the present day, I would say, legend about Thomas of Cama is based on that Portuguese text. So, for example, as long as anything can be explained, however, because everybody knew that in the normal grants, as long as the sun and the moon would last, should be included. But it's not in the Portuguese text. The close to royal privileges is again a very important tradition of the Christians, but it's not in the Portuguese text. It is clearly in this first paragraph, which is in the indirect tradition of the Kunjan copper plate, and it was clearly there in the lost plates as well, because it was only misread by the one who read it. Now, it doesn't mean that it was not in Waterloo. Even Damiao de Goes' report says that these Chaldean and Arabic characters were intermingled in the text. Something like that. Now, I don't have the text with me, so I can't now check. So it's... nothing is correct from what I presented, one message should be accepted, that we cannot treat these documents without an integral view on the indirect tradition. Can you accept it, Father Biju?
No, there is no problem. With regard to some of the points that you have said, I would like to say that Veera Raghava Pattayam, which we had the great fortune to visit it yesterday itself at the Avalokan Kottayam Aramana, and it is written in one plate and both sides are written. So it's possible that the chapters can be written on either side of the plate. So it's not said that it cannot be. And possibly because that Knaithaman chapter would be in one plate as the content of the matter, and the rest would be, the signatures would be on the other plate. So it could be well explained that it would be written on both sides of the one plate. And in the Portuguese reports, it's written that there are Indian names as witnesses as well, just like the reports of Ross, etc. So these names written in another other languages would be suffixing to the already given Indian names. Maybe, I don't know, it's a possibility. Anyway, that can be. With regard to the Portuguese period records, I would also suggest that there are ancient songs related to our community which is sung, and we have got written palm leaves from early 18th century. In those songs, the privileges that were given, the 72 widower, etc., are mentioned and are practiced during the customs and traditions of this community during marriages, etc. So the whole gives a sense that it is a practiced. And in the church of Todubira, Chungam church, there is a crown called Venthan Mudi, which is also referred in the text, the Portuguese text, of course, and in the songs. So there is a remnant of what is given as an archaeological fact or archaeological piece that exists today also. Then there is a song of Panans, which exactly speaks of the activities of Knaithoma and the privileges that he has got, and the copper plate that he has got from Chairman Perumal, and a copy of which is taken and kept taken on granite, which is kept on in the campus of a temple in Kodungallur. So the whole gives us a possibility that the these things are right. And in the report of Damya Ghosh, one just a single word makes us more comfortable in the sense that the wire hung on both the plates is put on the upper side. And in the Therisapalli chapters, we see the holes in the lower side of the left side, but in the lower side. And if it is written upper side, I think the writing would be in a vertical manner rather than horizontal. So it would further suggest, further be a suggestive of the signatures in the Therisapalli copper plates would be a part of the Knaithaman chapter. That's just a suggestion, just a hypothesis that we have to work on it. Okay, thank you.
As I told, what I am proposing is a hypothesis, and what you say about the upper part, unfortunately, I am I had this Damiao Goesh report with me, but now I am in Greece and didn't take it with me from Hungary. So I can't directly check it, but perhaps I am wrong, but that is to say, the most daring part of my hypothetical reconstruction is that odd paragraph in the indirect text tradition belongs to the lost Thomas of Cana plates. So this upper part, lower part should be. Let me just have a look on the. Yeah.
The fourth plate has holes on upper and lower parts, but the remaining has only in the lower part. The hole is on the lower part.
Now the fourth plate has two holes, one above and one below. The signatures, the Arabic and other signatures have at the upper part, and they are vertically written. The first plate has clearly a hole in the lower part. The second plate in the upper part. So it's not a very easy issue. The hole with which the second plate was held together was in the upper part. But no, because the second plate is written so that on the recto side, it's on the upper part, and the verso side, it's on the lower part, because it is inversely written.
Okay.
The third plate has on the recto side the hole on the upper part, and the verso side on the lower part, because it is also inversely written.
Okay.
You see, so this is not a conclusive argument, because even although it's one text, the Tarisapali copper plates, it is put together from, and of course in the first plate you can't say upper part or lower part, because it's written only on one page. The verso page is
on the left side. Since it is written horizontally, it would have been well said in the left side. Only when we write in the horizontal, sorry, vertical line, we say on the upper part. That's what I wanted to say.
What I think is that all these plates were bound together through those holes, because basically there was one hole for each. And this is how they were bound. So this is not a conclusion, the upper side or lower side, because it's so variegated, that it's not conclusive. And the fourth plate has two holes, moreover.
Okay. And so again, in the report of Luperon, he states that this is comprising of four plates, not five. He mentioned of four plates, not of five.
That's indeed very interesting. I also noticed this. All the indirect tradition speaks about four plates. So the fifth plate is not mentioned there. So I think that your proposal, that the one who said there was something in Chaldean and Arabic characters, the Arabic he could certainly recognize. Already the Chaldean can mean Pahlavi. So it can, I also thought that the only thing that is close to that description is the fifth plate of the column copper plates.
Okay.
But how to put all this together, that's not an easy issue.
That's true.
But if it's possible that...
What is stated by Luperon, I think, there cannot be a fifth plate as a continuation of the present fourth plate. Because if it is only four plates, we have already got the three plates, and we have to discuss only on the fourth plate. And the fourth plate is written so elaborately that it finishes with the Vijaya. So the text is completed. I think it would be an omission, which is a suggestion from Dr. Jacob Kollavarambil, that it's an omission of the Malayalam signatories and the part which he says that is a content of the only a content that is omitted from the Perisapalli copper plate. That's an assumption given by Dr. Jacob Kollavarambil. So that is also a possibility. So with these four copper plates, the plate, the document would have been finished, ended. The other one would be another possibility, opens for another possibility, that in the text of the Perisapalli copper plates, two times it is stated that Munnam Petudaya. Munnam Petudaya, that is given earlier, as given earlier. So Dr. Kollavarambil argues that the content given at the end, as that of the Knaitham and Shepherd, would be a recalling to the Munnam Petudaya, what was given earlier.
Yeah, I have read.
That is true. The Knaitham and Shepherd would have been given earlier than the Perisapalli shepherd. Again, that we cannot say that a shepherd is given after given document after that is given.
Sir, excuse me, may I enter in for a moment? May we open the house for there are a few other questions that have come up also. So shall we move on to them? The next query is from Dr. Susan Vishwanathan. May I request Dr. Vishwanathan to directly ask the query? Or Dr. Vishwanathan? Otherwise, may I request the admin to please read out the query because it is not visible in my chat box. Admin, could you please read out the query from Dr. Susan Vishwanathan?
Susan Vishwanathan, thanks, Istavan. I was curious why the historians like Morius, Podipara and Hambaye and others in the 1960s suggested that Manjism originated from the Persian prophet and magical money in the third century.
Can you repeat it, please? Excuse me.
I was curious why the historians like Morius, Podipara and Hambaye and others in the 1960s suggested that Manjism originated from the Persian prophet and magician money in the third century.
I don't know. I think because money, the name money is there, but of course, money means, if I'm not wrong, rupee. So it's. I have encountered this several times. The idea that perhaps there was manichaeism in India, but there is absolutely no trace for that. Nothing. So I think it's a misunderstanding of the name Manika Vachakkar, which is in this text, in the Leiden text, which shouldn't be unique, is mentioned as Manika Vachar. But it's clearly an Indian name. It has nothing to do with money. That's all I can say about this, Susan.
Admin, could you read out the next query, please?
And Susan Elias, if it is okay, could we request her to repeat his inference on Sapir issue or Spar issue? Apologies for the inconvenience caused. Sorry, it's maybe during the presentation time.
No, but I couldn't understand. Sorry.
If it is okay, could we request sir to repeat his inference on Safir issue, Bas Par issue?
Marwan Safir issue. Marwan Safir issue. Okay. Marwan Safir issue. The name. There was a debate that there are two names in the grant. And to both of them, the foundation of the Tarisapalli is attributed. Marwan Safir Isho is one form, and Isho da Tapir Ai is the other form. So there was also the idea in some literature, it is proposed that that these are two different persons, because the two forms do not match. But on the one hand, this tapir with a ta can be read as sapir, because in the Waterloo writing and in all the Dravidian writings, this ta sa, and even in the Gershon Marayan, this ta sa variation is normal. So we don't have to read it tapir, we can read it sapir. Then we are closer, the two names are already there. Isho da sapirai and Marwan Safir Isho. So I think that the two names, and it's even evident that the two names are identical. And this is a very good thing for us, because this, our reading of the name should correspond to both versions. Now, this Marwan was by some people read, and I find it widespread. Now, I don't want to quote, but because I think it's an error, I don't want to quote who commits this error, but it's very widespread to read Marwan as Mar. And then it would mean a bishop. But it's very clearly stated that this is a merchant. And Marwan is a well-attested Persian name, and it is very much used by the Christians, although not exclusively. It's also used in Arabic. Isho is Jesus. There is no question about this. There remains this question of Sapir. And Safir Isho was understood by many as Sabrisho. Sabrisho means in Syriac, hope in Jesus. But this doesn't work for some reasons. One is that Sabrisho is typically a cleric's name in the Syriac Church. And also the other form, Esho da Sapirai, it would not correspond. So I think that because Sapir is a good Syriac word, meaning the learned, the erudite, that this is what it means. Was this clear? So there is a merchant who is called Marwan Safir Isho, and whose name is confounded with the name Safir Isho at an early date. Now, because this is not in the grant, but in the traditions that there were two bishops, Mar Shabur and Mar Afrahat, coming with the merchant Safir Isho, and because Shabur was transcribed by some Portuguese texts as Sapor, because the Portuguese could easily pronounce S, S, Esh, Sa, S, Sha. So there was this terrible confusion between who is called Mar Sapor corresponding to the Persian name Shabur, and Sapirisho. But this doesn't work because the bishop was not Sapor, but Shabur. I think that this error of identifying the merchant with one of the bishops, who are only in the tradition, but it's a strong tradition, should be abandoned. And also, it is very interesting that the grant doesn't speak about anything religious. It is a legal act between a merchant community and a governor. That bishops were also coming, that we know from the church tradition. Which doesn't mean we have to reject the church tradition, but it is not part of the copperplates. And confusing the bishop with the merchant doesn't work. So that would be my answer.
Hello.
Yeah.
Shall I read out the next query?
Yes, please.
It's from Vishnu Nambudiri. He asks, what are the conclusive documents that suggest that the Christians were also referred to as Buddhists, as you were saying in the beginning of the lecture?
Yeah. That's a very good question. We have many such documents. In the Triponitura Sanskrit College, for example, we found a palm leaf document, the title of which is Bautha Shastra Charitram, the history of the teaching, of the holy teaching of the Buddhists. I think Shastra Charitram here simply translates theology. And Bautha translates Christian, because it's a Christian theological treatise. Bautha, in the Hindu parlance, can mean Christian, can mean Buddhist, as long as Buddhists were there, but generally, how to say, non-Orthodox Indian religions and Judaism, Christianity, and Islam were considered as such, could also be called Bautha. And there is a very interesting statue in the possession of the Elamkulam Catholic Art Museum, which is a wooden statue of the infant Jesus in the form of the Buddha. And I think we know that there were no statues before the Portuguese came, so I think that the Portuguese were ordering statues from local craftsmen before the models were coming from Europe. The only model about which a local artist could think, a local woodcarver, was the statue of the Buddha. So this association of the, I can't say heterodox religions, because this is an adoption of a Western concept, but of the non-Hindu religions, which are Indian religions, however, the closest association was with Buddhism. They had to name it somehow. When a person speaks about Buddhists, we cannot be sure that it's about Buddhists, in fact. No, I can't hear you.
Can you hear me?
No, yes, yes.
We have another small query from the same person. What about Marwan from Persian Arabic word Maharban, the theory of which I had heard somewhere in the past?
I have not heard this theory. But I have to rely on the uniform reading of the text by MGS Narayanan, by Raghava Varier, by Keshavan Veluta. I can't read. I am trying to read what I wrote, and I believe I have read one text, but it's not an easy issue. And what is written there, according to the reading of the experts, is Marwan. And Marwan is a perfectly good reading, because this is a well attested Persian name. That the community was Persian, which came to Kollam, is very clear also from the expression Tarisapalli. There was a lot of debate about this, and even as a Syriacist, I thought it has to do with the with Trisa, that is to say, I have to plug in my computer because it will just excuse me, allow me to plug in my computer. Because otherwise I will drop that. Hello, Professor Perczel. Your audio is on mute. Sorry, I was muted. Now can you hear me?
Yes. Yes.
Okay. So what I wanted to say is that I don't see why this good reading of Marwan should be changed.
Thank you, sir. We don't seem to have any further queries. May I request Professor Michael Taravan to kindly continue with the proceedings?
Thanks, everyone, to have participated in the discussion. I'm sure that a more detailed discussion on some of these issues that you have already raised would be of great welcome, great interest too. In fact, you know, there's been a renewed interest in this Tarisapalli copper plates. Primarily because of the publication of the book Tarisapalli Patayam by M.R. Raghava Varier and Dr. Keshavan, in which, of course, they do a kind of a critical review of what the kind of writings which has gone beyond. And certainly, the Kerala historians community as well as the social science community has been at it for a long time on at various levels. And in this review,
Professor Taraka, no, we can't hear you. I can't hear anything now.
I think his connection has a problem. I think we can wait for 1 minute and he'll be
back. Yeah, yeah, all such things happen in these yes, webinars. I also left the meeting.
While we wait for Professor Taragan, there was a query that came after. I'll just read it out. If there is time, maybe. It says, it's from Deepthi Shelley. If the likely establishment of foreign Christian settlements in Kodumallur and Kollam were in the 9th century CE, then were the traditions of 7.5 churches originate in the 9th century CE itself?
That's too difficult a question. Because the tradition of the seven churches, I have read about this what Matthias Mundadam has written, and he writes that, he studied extensively the early Portuguese documents. And he writes that the same tradition can also be found about the Coromandel coast. So that Saint Thomas founded seven churches. And also, so there are variations of the seven churches. And in the Leiden manuscript, one of the seven churches is Mylapore. It is what I can see from what I have read until now is that there were so that it doesn't mean that the Kerala community is not older than the 9th century, because even this Leiden, this church history and other church histories say that Christianity was abolished in around Chennai, in Mylapore, then the remnants who were not forcibly converted to Hinduism fled to Kerala. Now, there is a very interesting little detail in Marco Polo's narrative, because he visited the tomb of Saint Thomas in Mylapore, and he writes that the I don't remember very well. He writes that that the tomb is maintained by Christians who from the income of some groves. I don't know whether it's areca groves or a certain tree, which can be found only in Kerala, not in Tamil Nadu. So it's clear that the tomb, even in the 13th century, when was Marco Polo? 14th century, when he came to India, the tomb was maintained from Kerala. Those connections have not been completely broken. And it seems that there was a community in the eastern coast, and that was the main community, because apparently in the time when Christianity came, that was the main, that was the capital of all this Tamilaka. And there was also a community in the Western Coast. And from this whole community, only the Western Coast community survived. But it doesn't mean that the origins are not earlier of the Western Coast. But the importance of the Western Coast community increased when the Eastern Coast community was destroyed. But about the seven churches, how old this tradition is, it's very difficult with oral traditions which got noted sometime in history, where their origin, where to place their origin.
I think Professor Michael Taragan is back. Sir, could you? So your mic is on. Yeah, it's okay.
Now. Yeah, Rachel, you can now sum up and conclude if there's no more questions, no more.
There are no more queries, sir. Sir, would you like to say something to wind up the session?
I thought I said something which I,
yes,
I don't know whether
unfortunately in the middle of it got cut, so I was wondering if you would want to
I would just say thanks once again to Professor Istvan, and also thank everyone for sparing their time, valuable time, to come and attend this program. And we will be regularly holding such webinars in this.
Hello. I believe we have lost the connection again.
Participation.
Hello.
Hello.
Hello, can you hear me?
Yes, sir, the audio is not very clear.
Okay, then forget it. Won't be able to.
Okay, sir. Thanks a lot. Thanks a lot, Professor István, for the very dense informative talk and the compelling arguments. Thank you very much again. And we would like to announce that on the 29th of July, we will have our next webinar by Dr. Amit Parameshwaran of School of Arts and Aesthetics, JNU, on historicizing theatricality, the tragic tone beyond Kannada Nadagavedi. And once again, thank you all for being a part of the Elamkulam Kunjan Pillai Memorial Annual Public Lecture. Thank you.
Let me also thank everybody. And I especially thank those who have asked questions and addressed criticisms, because they are very useful for me. And I saw that some people asked for my email. Please share my email and my contact with who want to get in contact with me. And I see that the record will be available on YouTube, and that will be wonderful. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir. So anyone who wishes to have Professor Istvan's contact may please email us to kchrdkp@gmail.com.
Bye.
Thank you. Bye. Thank you.